Before we do another thing, we'd like to thank you all very much. Thank you. Got to take a little second here to get it all together. There's a lot of different reasons why people are here tonight. And before we do anything further, we'd like to thank one of the greatest staffs in all the Rock, the staff here at the Fillmore East. Yeah. And of course, the man gave us the honor to be here tonight, standing right over there, Mr. Bill Graham. I think he originally started this whole thing so everybody can be entertained and have a little fun. That's what we're going to try to do. I think tonight's going to be all right. Yes. We'd like to do a thing, one of our tunes we kind of do when get a little sentimental. Nice thing like this. We don't want to get it too loud now. People, who need people? You gonna help me on this one? Crazy baby, little drumming on me. Now right up there, you're doing it, but you gotta do it some more. Show me what you got.
We'd like to introduce the band. Thank you. Welcome, baby. Mr. DK. On keyboard, Mr. Seth Justin.
Ha ha ha! Some of you may have come a little later, missed some of the other people you might know here, so while we're changing around a bit, we'll raise the house lights and you might try saying hello to one another.
Smith from backstage at the Fillmore. I don't know whether you heard this a second ago. And Jay Giles just finished, and they've gone back upstairs to their dressing room, and they're moving out new equipment and everything like that out on the stage. And next will be Edgar Winter and White Trash. That'll be the next group that you're going to hear in this live concert. And we'll be back from the Fillmore momentarily, and now back to the studio.
We are
bathed
back,
in the indigo light backstage at the Fillmore while they're switching equipment for Edgar Winter to go on.
Said the Jay Giles band just brought this place crazy. Maybe made them crazy. It was fantastic. Yeah. It's fantastic.
As Mike was saying before, they were cooking tonight. Let's see, who is in this little crowd here? We have Mike Klempner.
Mountain is going on now?
Yeah.
Oh! Okay, Mountain is next.
All right, Jay Giles has just finished a very fine performance, and Mountain is coming on, right, Mike?
Yeah, this looks like him.
This is Mike Harrison with Howard Smith.
Dave Herman.
Mike Klempner.
What I just noticed a minute ago here is for this momentous occasion tonight, the level of groupies are very high. The way they're dressed and the way they look.
Classy.
Very classy night for groupies.
Well, Allison Seale has just joined us.
Hi, everybody.
Hi, Allison.
We've just spoken to everybody from downstairs. It's a little warm down there and a lot of technicians, a lot of equipment. So we kind of came up to see what was going on backstage.
You had the opportunity to hear a concert above you from speakers and on television. How is that?
As a matter of fact, we're in the basement with where the technicians are, right below the stage, and Jay Giles was so spirited as he went one, two, we had a vision of him coming right through the floor onto the console, which would have been different.
Sure. Scene out of the Marx Brothers.
Let me interject for a second. I think you announced Mountain would be next.
Yeah, it's a flash bulletin.
The Allman Brothers.
It's the Allman.
No. It really is. It is Edgar Winter.
It is Edgar Winter,
but they're playing through Mountain's equipment. So
I see.
I balled up by looking at Mountain.
All right, we have
as
a Mountain.
As you can see, we have
Edgar
everything
Winter.
Completely straight back
exactly
here.
Right.
That's exactly where it's at.
First, let's describe exactly the scene that we're standing in. The ember lights. What is this? A bluish
indigo lights.
Indigo lights.
And you're standing in a kettle drum.
Uh-huh.
I'm in a tuba.
We're not everything's normal.
But we're enjoying it. We're backstage. They're building the set for the play. And there
the
is equipment all over the place. Drums, guitars, and people coming and going. How's the audience doing? Are they still here?
They're stretching now. They're taking their, they're kind of stretching their legs and moving around and being a little sociable, as Bill suggested.
It seems the audience is they're friendly to each other. They seem to know each other.
Well, it's kind of a tradie audience, Mike. These are people in the business. I know when I came in, 20 people that you maybe haven't seen in a while grabbed you. Hi, how are you? It's a very kind of in audience. And
it's a party.
It's a very warm
the city thing. Agents, people from record companies.
Yes,
The order of priority for tickets tonight was kind of interesting because, as usual, people who work on radio stations and at newspapers and all that get first good tickets. And tonight, most of those people tonight are up in the balconies and the mezzanine. They gave the staff of the Fillmore first preference.
Right on.
Well, I think that was part of the...
I think it was good.
It's a typical Bill Graham gesture. I think the staff has done such a tremendous job.
Yeah,
I came down to the Fillmore one day last week. Before a performance, I was here, and Bill was doing his warm-up.
Right.
And the thing that impressed me so, and here's an operation that is 4 days away from closing, and instead of letting it slide and saying, oh, well, let's dispense with this kind of thing, he didn't. You'd think he was going to be in business forever, the way he sat everybody down. And he impressed me so with the remarks he made to the staff. you know, he said there's going to be a lot of attention on us right up to the very last minute. And he wanted all the same courtesy, all the same efficiency. And but couched it in such nice, warm terms. I mean, you couldn't help but admire the man. For being so thoroughly professional right up to the last minute.
It seems that tonight is, rather than a final drifting out end, a culmination of three and a half years.
It's a peak, there's no question.
It's going out on a peak.
It's the zenith. I mean, you couldn't top it, so...
I don't know. I kind of felt that maybe it passed already.
Really?
Yeah, last year sometime I felt.
The whole musical peak.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm talking about the Fillmore peak.
Fillmore peak. Oh, this is it.
Right. Right. Oh, so what do you think's next?
I don't know.
I don't know what
effect this is going to have on rock. Do you think it's going to have any effect on rock?
I think that the whole, all the talk that's come out recently about the Fillmore closing being the death of rock, as you read, I think that is just a very quick...
Jumping to
a conclusion
that isn't just voicing of everyone's fears. I mean, they're afraid it might happen, and they say, "Oh, you know, this is the end." I don't think it's the end.
I think it's just another chapter.
Yes,
in the history of rock, rock is building up a history. And this is another chapter. What would you say?
It's kind of the same thing when the old Metropolitan Opera was torn down.
Right.
It was such a tremendous emotional thing among opera buffs. I mean, you know, the analogy is there, progressive music buffs. And it didn't signify the end of anything. It meant that opera moved to a new environment, a new home, and it's here. And progressive rock will, someplace else, some other person who is courageous and has foresight and a lot of gumption will come along and develop maybe another theater, who knows. And it will continue, it'll grow. As long as there are good musicians,
that's it.
It will grow, no question.
And there are good musicians.
The light show screen has now been lowered, so I guess they're getting a little...
We can no longer see the audience.
Dave, do you just come from the audience?
Yeah.
What's happening out there?
Well, they've got all the house lights up, and the people are so unbelievably mellow. It's really almost quiet out in the house. People kind of just absorbing what the Jay Giles Band just did, and really just kind of hanging out with each other. It's really nice.
Free goodies tonight.
Everybody's in their seats, just kind of mingling with the people next to them.
Graham Simple had free goodies for everybody tonight, where normally they sell stuff at the concession. There's all free cake.
We're on the lobby.
Free
goodie. We're going.
What's happening?
It's free cake.
That wasn't that far. Beer.
Yeah.
Oh, yes?
So,
candy and ice cream and also
corn chips.
Various and sundry.
Well, it is really a party more than a Fillmore concert. The last Fillmore concert was last night. This is a big party.
When we walked in, into the lobby, everyone had like a glass in their hand. That's why I said it was more like a cocktail party atmosphere.
It's really interesting what's happening right here, too, that, you know, two radio stations just kind of cooperate so nicely and do
this. I wonder if this is a first day.
Probably. Well,
in a major city between two stations, I think so.
Yeah. Well, I think, I don't think it would be possible. Or it wouldn't have been possible a few years ago, but in our milieu today, I think we all realize that we're all doing the same thing, is bringing great music to the people, and there
That's
is no...
That's significant, that by through cooperating
right.
rather than competing with each other,
well,
this is happening.
There is, you know, it's such a big market, and there is room, and we all want the same thing, and that's why there isn't that fiery competitive spirit. You know, you're working for a common goal, and that is... to bring as much music as you can to as many people. And it's a nice feeling, it's a warm feeling.
Let me see if I can find Peter Wolf and bring him over here. I think it would be really nice to talk to him.
Al Jardine of the Beach Boys is about to come up. Right?
Al Jardine of the Beach Boys.
How do you do?
How are you doing?
Becoming asphyxiated in the cellar down there, talking about
I see you sitting on the side there taking it all in. What's happening down there now, or what's happening up here?
I'm not. I wasn't up here, so I can't tell you what's happening up here. But I've been watching the monitors, you know, downstairs, and just picking up on the people breaking in, getting rushed out one door and into another. Right. I couldn't believe it. It was really fantastic. And but they're very kindly treated and very discreetly ushered out in two different directions. It's very confusing, but it was cool, you know. And. I don't know. It's been really great. The atmosphere here is like really charged.
The Beach Boys are going to do a set later.
Yeah, we've been invited.
Great.
Really, it was really neat. They invited us to do like at least six numbers or seven numbers. I'm really happy about it.
Throughout all of the questioning and the talking between people tonight, everybody's been saying, what do you think this signifies, the closing of the Fillmore, as far as the history of rock goes? And I think that we have you here. The Beach Boys have been with the rock scene for so long now, through so many ages of rock. How do you feel about the closing of the Fillmore and rock today and the Beach Boys part in it?
Well, I would rather speak allegorically at this point and say that a certain amount of destruction is necessary for the creation of anything else in any form, whatever you happen to be speaking. And I think rather than saying it's a negative trip, it's probably going to make way for something else, which will probably enhance what's happening.
Now, you guys have been through a lot of various changes and everything. You know,
changes,
I mean, through all different rock scenes, you know.
Yeah, it's like, that's why I have to speak allegorically, because I don't even know, you know, it's just all in space right now.
Kind of feeling these days, I know people, no matter what they do, can feel certain ground swells that peak, go through peak and valley periods, all people and whatever they do. And it seems to me there's a kind of a big ground swelling under the Beach Boys these days. Is it something that you're all aware of? And
Yeah, we're aware of it, and it's inexplicable, really. It's just happening. I think we may have been, production-wise and musically, in another place at another time, and maybe that time is happening. I don't know.
There's a lot of people looking forward to what might happen from all of it, you know, to being in the right place at the right time.
So that's it. No doubt. There it is. Is that the...
Who's warming up now?
That's Edgar Winter warming up on Mountain's Equipment. Edgar Winter on Mountain's Equipment. So, as I said before, we're going to have a little bit of Mountain and Edgar Winter.
Oh, wow.
His white trash band is here too, right?
Right. Mm.
And you'll be on later, all right?
I guess. I think somebody gave me 5. I don't know if that means 5 minutes or 5 days or 5 years.
$5.
$5. Right. Anyway, it's neat. And it's really nice to be here. I don't know what else to say.
Let me ask you a question. When the Beach Boys are in concert now, and I know you're touring a lot, is the audience a new audience, or is it the old Beach Boy audience that has grown older? For the most part.
No, I'd have to say that, in as much as we haven't been on the road a great deal, that I can very assuredly say it's a new audience, because I think it's something about time that is catching up or whatever, that suddenly we're into another era, another time, with basically the same trip that maybe wasn't understood at our time, and I think people now are getting into it. I don't know. But it is definitely a new trip, a new generation. And I hope that we're there. You know,
Paul ushering the white trash. Ned Gwinter's.
I just spoke to Al Jardine of the Beach Boys. The last thing. It's a new trip and a new generation. Thanks for coming over here, Al.
Just to interject for a second, Cat playing guitar with Edgar is...
Yeah, but...
The cat playing guitar with Edgar Winter is something, and I don't think we're ever going to find out, because...
It's Rick Derringer going to be playing guitar, but, my master's voice.
Rick Derringer playing guitar with Edgar Winter.
We have another guest here.
Eddie Kramer. Electric Ladyland, and has produced hundreds of albums. Right?
You flatter me, thank you.
Would you name them for us? 30 seconds before to the stage. What do you think of this tonight, Kramer?
I'm very, very sad to see it happen. I mean, I've done a lot of nice albums from this place, and I made a lot of friends.
Usually you're out in a truck mixing, right?
I'm outside. Usually I am. Tonight I'm inside and watching it.
Thanks for stepping up to the mic.
Okay.
We're going to move out to the performance on stage now, so I'm told, in about 20 seconds.
Yeah, I'm not.
We're waiting for Edgar Winter's White Trash Band to start. Howard Smith and Mike Harrison and Allison Steele and Pete Sanatel.
It's like everybody you ever knew in the business is out there, you know. And hi, and how are you? And isn't it a great show?
To Bill Graham. Graham is about to announce. Okay.
Test.
Okay, we're waiting for Edgar Winter and White Trash to come on right now. And the next voice you will hear should be Bill Graham making an announcement, an introduction from the stage.
So we're told. Let's hope.
Now where would I be without you, baby? There's a reason.
You know I need you, darling. Baby, I need you to get me. Oh, somebody gotta get me. Baby, why don't you get me? Oh, you gotta get me. Oh, baby, I need some. Baby, I need you to get me right on through. Come on, baby. Come on with me. Yes. Tonight, Lord, I want y'all. You got to get it on. Yeah, you do.
My first epic album, Tobacco Road.
Oh.
I've saved my money.
You know I love you 'cause you're home. 'Cause you're home. I love you. 'Cause you're home. 'Cause you're my home. 'Cause you're my home. Hey!
WPLJ New York.
Thank you. Song we're gonna do for you tonight. And we hope we can bring everybody together. Everybody come together. Clap your hands. Clap your hands. Clap your hands. Clap your you took it down, tore it apart. You left me sitting in the dark. You said your love would be worth it. I beg of you, baby. I beg of you, baby. I beg of you, baby. I'm down on my knees. I turn on the lights. Let it shine on me. I turn on your love light. Let it shine on me. Let it shine, 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 let it shine. Everybody, come on, baby.
Turn on your love light, baby. Do you hear me talking to your children? Ella, I want you to turn on your love light. And don't never let it die. Don't never let it die, baby. You got to let it shine. It's got to keep on shining, baby. Oh! It ain't gonna shine on me. It's gonna shine on you.
We hope you're having an enjoyable evening. We certainly are. Thank you. Try doing your thing in the dark, honey.
Okay, we're backstage here at the Fillmore again in the indigo light. It was Edgar Winter's White Trash. And Scott Muni and Mike Cascuna's here with me, and Howard Smith. What do you think, Scott?
Well, I think probably the reason the sets are a little longer is they're anticipating a lot more. And I think some of the people are obviously going to be in on a large jam. At least that seems to be what the talk is. Mountain is standing by. I know I saw Leslie West.
Who's next, Mountain?
Mountain, for sure.
Mountain.
Mike Kleffner is here, too. Mountain is going to be on shortly, so
that should be very short.
It's really unfortunate because I've been sitting out in the audience for most of the concert so far, and I hate to say this, but I think radio is a poor medium for the last two groups that we're on. Did you go out at all? With Jay Giles Band and Edgar Winter's White Trash, the stage acts were
incredible, yeah.
Like really superb. Really.
Mike, you've been here since the opening of Fillmore, almost.
Well, about a year after.
I think that's one of the things a lot of the people are denied, the chance to see the same act that they can hear alive, and it is an incredible difference.
Incredible. Really. A group like Jay Giles.
Okay, we're going to go back now, I guess, momentarily to the studio and then back here to the Fillmore for some more music. Okay, we're backstage here at the Fillmore again. Standing here with us is Bill Graham. Bill, this is it. This is the last night.
This is the Guns of McGilla, right.
Are you going to go back to waiting on tables at the Concord after this?
times go bad, but I don't think so. No, I go up there to visit to see the head waiter who years ago said I would end up as a bum.
Is that what the head waiter said?
Irving and I never get along.
Maybe Irving ended up.
Well, that's his description of success, and God will bless him in his 17 tuxedos.
To explain the music that's going on right now, they're showing Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs on the screen, while Mountain is setting up. Mountain going on next, I guess.
Bill, do you think there's any difference in this audience tonight at all? Like, do you notice any?
Oh, yeah. It's you can't say it's better or worse. It's a different audience because you have some of the people who might not normally come here. We have Esther and her family, some Shack's Delicatessen. We have the guy from the pizza parlor across the street. We have people in the clothing stores, and some of the merchants who are in the neighborhood but don't normally come in. And we have the friends and the ushers and the stagehands and their parents and their cousins and their elders. And you have the record company industry people who may produce your records and merchandise them and sell them, but don't that often frequent our place or other halls. So you have a lot of people who aren't familiar with our hall and the easy aspects of the way we work here. So you have an audience who that may not be as physically exuberant, and if they do enjoy the music, it's much more of a mental thing. But the body isn't that much into it. But you have the strange thing is that you have the young people that are interspersed among the older people who are getting it up anyway because their energy is so high. So it affects everybody. Right. It's very much like years ago when people were always asking why aren't there fights in the early dances in San Francisco in 66, 67. It's because the older people were coming to see what this new phenomenon was, and the young people were so affected by the older people being around. They didn't want to rumble because they knew it was wrong. It's like mommy and daddy are here, and we don't rumble when mommy and daddy are around. Well, tonight it's sort of a meeting of the old and the young of rock. It's a very strange relationship
in my mind. This is a very, in a way, an unfair question. It's like, which child do you love best? But is there a different feeling or a different consciousness or attitude that you have between the Fillmore East and the Fillmore West? Or is it just one
thing? No, I have to admit that there is one. The other one is pure emotion. I live there. I am very close to the community here. I must admit that the closeness is more to the artist, to the staff. But here, I can test my sense of theater more than I can out here because of the physical facility that it is a theater here as opposed to a ballroom. We have a backstage area, and also I happen to be blessed with the best stage crew. They're not schlocks. They're theater people. They know how to relate to the artists. They listen to the records weeks in advance. What do we do for this group? In other words, they have the capacity, the technical capacity, and the basic mentality.
Can I ask you this? Which Fillmore has made more money?
The East. The East, yes. Simply because in the West, it's much more. It's unfair to say that I've poured more money back. I poured more money back into the community out there. There's much more of an involvement with the free shows in the park and the Haight-Ashbury Medical Clinic and the.
The things that a lot of New York people objected about Fillmore East that they felt there should have been that same kind of involvement in New York as there was in San Francisco.
It's very difficult. I'll tell you why. Because I'm sorry that I would debate the point of the presence of a community in New York City. And if you're saying, Bill, you should have devoted your life to creating a community, you can't do that. In the beginning,
there really is no community in New York City.
What was I going to support? The clinic here? The clinic down here is supported. It's for them to tell you. If there's a high school graduation here, we had a high school graduation here a few days ago. I was the speaker here. We've had the benefits here that we think we should be involved with.
But what you're saying is that there is a community in San Francisco that doesn't exist in New York.
That there was a community that in San Francisco that no longer exists. And I don't ever remember there being a community here. In the beginning, when we started to put on the free shows on Wednesdays, when we said, all right, community, where are you? And all there was is the desire to have a crash pad for the heads,
It turned out to be everybody arguing with each other as to who would decide what would go on. I remember that one night, microphone.
Yes,
somebody said, a microphone is structure. I flew back into the city
to have a conversation with the street people and the merchants, and Ed Sanders from the iBookstore was supposed to mediate, and I said, fine, I flew back, it's 8 o'clock, and what was his name, Ben Morea, grabbed the microphone and said, this is our crash pad for the winter, it's a love-in, it's a peace-in, don't tell us about town meetings, we're taking over. I said, if this is the way you want to conduct meetings, you'll have to find some other way. And there was never that desire to really have a community. And I'm very sorry about that, but New York is not the kind of a city. It's such a... It's unmayorable. It's uncontrollable. It's over ethnic thighs, whatever you want to call it, the ethnic elements.
51st stage is what you're saying.
I think a lot of...
Fillmore should.
I think a thinner should be poured over New York. Just thin it out. And,
it out.
Well, stretch it out or put it through a sifter. Yeah.
But, well, I think the people in New York are less concerned with each other than they are on the West Coast.
But New York City... You can say all the negative. There were so many negatives about New York, and yet you have to come back here. This is Tar City. This is AC/DC. This is the challenge.
It's also the central energy force for a lot of things that go on all over the world.
But then the people here challenge you. You know, you're fighting for the bus, and you're fighting for the cab, and you're fighting for the elevator. If you can survive here, I mean, I'll be the first to tell you that the fortune that I've had, San Francisco was very good to me. But until I came to New York, until the trades came here, and until the people got to recognize the kind of work we do, it didn't happen really on a national scale until we got here, as good as San Francisco was. So we owe a lot to the success of Fillmore East and to the people who came here.
But did it cross your mind to perhaps close the Fillmore East and leave the Fillmore West run and just devote all your energy?
No, I must be honest. It crossed my mind to be the other way around, because I can do more from the theatrical standpoint here than I can on the West Coast. The ballroom limits you. The great advantage of the ballroom, that the flat level of the ballroom, I was able to play ball once a week. I built a basketball court on the ballroom floor, which you can't do here. But the theatricality of Fillmore East, the challenge of the public of New York City, made this. This is a mother, man. This town is it. You know, you get out there every day in New York City, and New York City says, all right, you know?
Good.
Yeah, no, you know, he says, all right, we're going
to
count your toes and count your fingers, because at the end of the day, look out. And that challenge is always there. And when I came back into New York to open the place here, and just when I, in San Francisco, I'll say to a kid, you know, go away from the door, they'll go away. New Yorker says, yeah, who are you? I mean, that 12-year-old kid in the streets is a fighter. This is a classic, by the way. It's a Frisbee film, which is a 2-minute long thing, which is one of the great films. If we can cut just a minute, we can all dig the film.
But they can't see it.
Well, then you describe it, but I'm gonna get a good film.
Okay.
Thank you for the time.
Okay, thank you, Bill.
Have a good time.
All right, Leah, let's describe the film. I think that's an interesting
idea. This is a, if we can do it. Come on.
The film was made by an NYU film student, and that's his dog. And there's been no editing, no, you know, nothing, no filling in or any part. This dog is just where it's at. It was done out in Long Island. It's an incredible film.
It's like a Labrador, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a mutt.
It's a mutt, yeah.
Running in slow motion. It reminds me of a film. Did you ever see Dream of Wild Horses?
Yes.
Very much like that.
This is on a lawn in front of the ocean, and the dog is chasing the frisbee, and the music in the background is the Valkyrie, Wagner's Valkyrie. And, you know, you just, it's an incongruity, the picture and the music. But the dog is magnificent. He plays better frisbee than I could ever hope to play.
What we're describing is a movie on the screen being shown to the audience now. And if you people at home listening to radio, put your head inside your speaker
with
the radio, you could see the film also.
It's in color, incidentally, full color, 3-dimension, in stereo. The dog has, at the big crash of the music, the dog has jumped into the water to get the frisbee. Fantastic. Beautiful job of filming.
It's great.
That has to be a trip, trying to picture a movie that someone else has paralyzed.
It's just like clarity and all this stuff.
Of course, the thing is, that dog wasn't too hot. He didn't throw it once.
Not bad for a chihuahua.
He only caught it.
And this film has played the Fillmore more than a Grateful Dead. So.
Is that right?
Really?
Yeah. The dog is a rock star.
Oh, yeah. And the other commercial, the other cartoon we usually show at the Dead Show, a little Sunshine commercial.
Yes?
Yeah.
Well,
Okay.
Oh, there was a lull in the conversation. There isn't much to describe standing backstage. It's very dark. When you first come up from downstairs, you can't see a thing. Of course, the lights are down, the screen is up, and there are people milling around, and we're just kind of looking for color and interesting things happening. But I think everybody's kind of laying out now, getting a breath, don't you think?
What's kind of interesting is the lobby upstairs.
Everybody else
for the first time in 2 years.
Exactly, yeah.
It's like old hungry, yeah. You walk through the door and it's...
It looks like a great big cocktail party. And everybody's kind of elbowed together with the drinks and, hey, man, how are you?
Chris, this hasn't turned as much into that kind of thing as I thought it would.
Oh,
I thought everybody would be, dressed in their newest hip clothes.
No,
everybody just came the way they wanted to.
It's a funky hangout kind of thing.
All the widows?
I got a Fillmore worker.
Okay, a Fillmore
worker. He says he's got a couple of stories to tell. Oh,
okay.
My name is Tony.
What stories do you want me to tell you,
Mr.
man?
Mr. Mizucci.
How are you, Vito? What are you doing?
Give us a story about how
we're
the screen fell one night.
The screen fell.
The screen fell one night?
I couldn't tell you that. No.
He's
on
our
who?
Assistant technical
on
director at the theater, and one night in between, no, this was an afternoon.
It was in the afternoon?
It was in an afternoon.
No, it was during a show. What are you talking about?
Right, whatever.
He's telling us.
It was on a Tuesday. No, it was on a Wednesday.
Yeah, this screen is kind of big, and all of a sudden one of his pylons broke from the... Tony, you can give him the technical aspect.
Well, I'll tell you what happened. I was standing there in the middle of the stage.
Wait a minute, it's supposed to be Tony, not Pat.
Oh. Well, my middle name is Patrick.
Oh, all right.
As a matter of fact.
Go.
Well, anyway, one afternoon, during a rehearsal, we were, we had just rigged the curved screen to a new set of ropes. I don't want to get into the technical thing because it's a whole big thing. And one of the ropes got tangled up, and the screen broke. And there were like 90 people running different directions. One of the guys just turned to me and said, hey, listen, why don't you fix the screen? And the screen was, like, hanging on, like, two ropes. And we're running around like crazy, and people are going, what's going on?
Through, please.
But,
hot stuff.
It was like, it was the fastest time I've ever seen anybody
you can just
move.
Just imagine about 100 people
backstage.
Trying to hold up this screen, which weighs about a ton and a half. It was kind of funny, and trying to set up the group in between, and the audience is wondering what's happening. And,
Mike, you've been to
Norfolk.
Oh, Bob Seed.
He's our technical director. He's been here. He's sort of like an old monument here.
Robert would be a good one to ask the question. I was going to ask, Mike, you've been here at the Fillmore a long time, and Bob and Tony. What was, in your estimation, the most exciting night, barring tonight now, the most exciting night you've ever witnessed here at the Fillmore?
It would be different. I think it was the night Jimi Hendrix played on New Year's Eve.
New Year's Eve, right.
That was out of sight.
I could dig that.
To me, it was most exciting. It was like, it's hard to say. There's like a lot of other times when I thought it was really exciting. The Grateful Dead was definitely.
Interesting evenings at the Fillmore.
The Who for 5 days. The first time The Who did that 5 day thing.
This theater, there have been so many great performances and so many. I think it would be really difficult to pinpoint one night that may be stuck in your memory for some special reason that would take precedence over.
I think 3.5 years will stick in my memory.
Probably, yes. Every nitty-gritty night.
Every Friday and Saturday night, two shows a night.
What was the worst night you ever had? For any reason.
We should mention names, right?
We should not do the deference to the group.
The worst night, the worst night we ever had in the way of a hassle was, there's two nights. We had the fire when The Who were here outside, and they had the fire. And the other night was when... one of the water tanks up in the roof sprung a leak.
Oh, yes.
And the backstage area was immersed in a few inches of rain from the ceiling above. And we had to rig up this big piece of plastic over the stairs to the dressing room tower to keep the dressing room steps from being too slippery so the performers wouldn't fall and everybody would break their neck. And so we had this great piece of plastic and a couple big barrels collecting the water off the roof.
Yeah, that was kind of...
That was probably one of the more interesting evenings, running around trying to find the leak. And,
undoubtedly, in the course of so many performances over 3.5 years, there were probably many... situations of which the audience was entirely unaware.
Yeah, you know, there's usually one a weekend.
Yeah, oh, right, yeah, right. Sure. A local catastrophe that they don't even know about.
Oh, for sure.
What are all you guys going to do now?
Superlatives in the like entertainment business are always
really?
No, I don't
very,
know.
Very often misused, it's, certainly it's, not this time. For back to Bill Green, good friends, for great musicians, an organ, Mr. Steve Knight. On bass and vocals, Mr. Felix Pappalardi. On lead guitar and vocals, Mr. Leslie West. The name is Mountain. We'll be right back.
we're here tonight because of one Bill Graham. Yeah. Man who I and we have always respected because he's always made it possible, never failing that we could present ourselves as best we knew how, and he worked very hard at it, and we'll miss him in this context. This next thing is from our climbing album. It's for him. City for the forest and further on, painted wagon of the morning, dusty roads where they have gone, sometimes traveling through the darkness. Let the summer coming home, falling faces by the wayside, looked as if they might have known. For the sun was in their eyes, and the days looked to dry. With a laughter sound. Oh, the dancing and the singing, oh, the music when they play. Oh, the fire that they're starting. Oh, the sometimes it kept it, often lost it along the way. Fought each other to possess it, sometimes died sight of day.